Good morning, everyone. We're going to be starting in just a minute. Welcome. This is a great time to turn on that gallery view if you want to wave hello to folks as you come into our virtual sanctuary this morning. Good to have you here with us. You can say hello to folks in the chat if you like. It's wonderful to have you joining us this morning from wherever you are, wherever this May morning finds you. It's good to have you here with us. We're going to get started in just a minute here. So come on in, settle in wherever you are, your coffee or your breakfast or on your couch or in your bed, in your jammies, however you find yourself this morning. It's good to be together. And I think we'll get started with our service. Good morning and welcome to the Unitarian Society of Santa Barbara. Welcome into this loving community of seekers, people who are striving to live with integrity, nurture wonder, and inspire the actions that transform us and transform the world. I'm the Reverend Julia Hamilton, and it's wonderful to have you here with us this morning in our Zoom sanctuary online. Wherever you may be, is a sanctuary this morning as we gather in this virtual space to do some real work. Today, we are going to be celebrating May Day in all of its incarnations. May Day and Beltane as the celebration of spring. May Day as International Workers' Day, when we lift up the work of the world and how it transforms us. And I am here this morning with, of course, a whole team of people who make this morning possible. We have Janie Madlani, one of our religious education coordinators, in the chat here. Ian Kennedy is on Facebook helping direct folks over to Zoom. I'm not sure if we're linked up with Facebook this morning, but hopefully we can get that going. We have Stephanie behind the scenes making it all happen. And Justine Sutton and Ellen Brody will be joining us this morning as worship associates. And of course, all of you who have taken this time to set aside to nurture your spirit together. So it is wonderful to have you with us this morning. If you are a visitor or a friend and family joining us from near or far, we would love to get to know you better. We hope you will stick around for our coffee hour after the service, where we'll have a chance to break into small groups and connect with new friends and old friends. If closed captioning is something that helps you connect to the service better, you can turn on that closed captioning. There's a little button, usually a little button that says more down at the bottom of your screen. And if you click on that, it'll give you an option to turn on or off closed captioning so you can see text underneath the service screen. And if you are visiting with us and want to stay connected to everything that's going on here at the Unitarian Society, you can click through in the link in our chat to our guest book so that we can add you to our communications list so that we can keep you updated on the life of the congregation and invite you to get to know us better as we get to know you better. We have a lot of things coming up this spring beyond Sunday morning gatherings. And of course, we are slowly navigating our return towards being able to gather more often in small groups and eventually together as a congregation. But hopefully hoping to retain some of this online life that we have cultivated over this year. So if any of you find yourself with a desire to help welcome people into this fantastic community, our membership ministry team is looking for you. We want to add some new folks to this team to help us navigate this transition back into our in-person gatherings, as well as maintain our connection through these new tools that we've learned. We've got some fun events planned for the summer. The membership ministry team is kind of our fun squad. They're the ones who put on potlucks and help us with celebrations, as well as welcoming newcomers into our midst. So, contact Sally Hamilton or Lorraine Gray if you would like to volunteer. No previous volunteer experience necessary. This is a great kind of first jump into congregational life. If you're newer to the congregation, the membership ministry team is a great place to start. One of the fun things that is being cooked up this summer is in August, we are anticipating putting on an art show. We have so many fabulous creative artists in this congregation. And as we've been apart, there has been creation happening. And in our arts and crafts meetup that meets every Monday is partnering with our membership ministry team to plan for an art show in August on campus where we'll have a chance to show off all of the wonder and beauty that you are creating. So if you are an artist, now is the time to get busy and start thinking about what you might like to contribute. And if you want to talk to our arts and crafts team that meets up on Mondays, Dana Zerzolo is a great person to talk to if you're interested in this plan for an art show coming up this summer. I want to give a special thanks to the folks on our flower committee for helping make our May Day celebration with our families a success yesterday. We'll be seeing more about that in the service and some beautiful flowers here behind me. But thank you to the folks who bring beauty into our lives every Sunday when they bring flowers into our sanctuary, whether it's a virtual sanctuary or our in-person sanctuary. And speaking of flowers, it is just 1 month away till the beginning of June, which is our annual flower communion. We have some good things coming your way, so keep an eye out for communications about how to participate in our flower ceremony this year. And that also means our annual meeting is coming up. The first Sunday in June is our annual meeting when we gather to do the work of this congregation. This is a congregation that exists because you show up and participate and lend your leadership and skills. And the annual meeting is a chance when we get to elect the new leadership for the coming year. We get to celebrate and honor the people who have done the work in the past year and look forward to what's ahead. So that is coming up on the first Sunday in June. Mark your calendars for both our flower communion and our annual meeting. I invite you now to take a breath, to center yourself wherever you are, perhaps to feel your body in the sanctuary of your home or outdoors or whatever space you are occupying in addition to this space here with us. And as I ring our bell, let the sound connect us. As we prepare to light our chalices this morning, if you have a candle or a chalice handy, now is the time to get that ready. And if anybody would like to help us light our virtual chalices, you can type into the chat, chalice is lit, and the name of the street or the town that you're joining us from, so that we can see all of those little sparks of our chalices being kindled wherever you're at. And Ellen Broidy has our words for our communal chalice lighting this morning.
The words for this morning's chalice lighting come from poet Richard Cole, who in a few lines lifts up the dreams and aspirations of work that is seldom acknowledged and rarely honored. The beauty of a strip mall is the beauty of a minor dream turned quietly aside at the end of the day. The beauty of the small impossible ledgers recording hope against subtraction and finally closed with a sigh. Every unremarkable donut shop is somebody's act of faith, and somewhere between almost and never quite, in the last miles of aging neon and plastic backlit signage, here too is poetry, where the books will someday be balanced and the future is always a bargain, everything 99 cents.
Thank you, Ellen. Every Sunday this year, we are taking up the practice of lifting up things that bring more love and justice into the world to remind us that every day, every week, people are doing the work of building beloved community. And we ask you to type into the chat places where you've noticed actions of love, actions that move us towards justice, whether they're small interpersonal exchanges or great big national movements that you're taking part in. You can go ahead and type that into the chat. We will add it to our love and justice jar. But what I wanna lift up this week some tremendous love is being poured through our Holding India program. Holding India program is a partnership between Unitarian congregations in India, and it's done through the international collaboration of Unitarian Universalists, because we do exist all over the world. And right now, with the pandemic unfolding in India at a tragic scale, this partnership is allowing us to reach out with love and compassion and direct funds and resources to those who need it, and also express our solidarity and our bonds of friendship that have existed for over a century with Unitarians in India. So I want to lift up the work of the Holding India Project, especially right now when it is so needed to remind us that we are all interconnected, and what happens in one place of the world affects each and every one of us, no matter where we live. So you can go ahead and add your notes into the chat if you've seen places where people are bringing more love into the world, or acts of care and kindness that have reminded you the ways that we can hold each other during hard times. You can add that to the chat at any time. One of the ways that we hold each other in this congregation is by celebrating our birthdays, celebrating that each and every one of us comes into this world and is a blessing. And so we offer a birthday blessing to those who are born each month on the first Sunday of the month. And this is our first Sunday of May, which means it's time to celebrate all of our May babies. So thank you to everyone who sent in a picture to be part of our birthday slideshow. If you have a birthday or the birthday of someone you love is in May and you wanna add that to the chat while we play our slideshow, and then we're all going to collectively send our love to our birthday folks this month. Join with me in the spirit of blessing to all of you whose birthdays are in May. May this coming year unfold for you with joy and health and wisdom. May you find your soul growing deeper. May you be sparked with joy at the wonder of the world. May you have friends to laugh with you in the good times and cry with you in the hard times. The world is a richer place because you are in it, and we are so glad that you were born. Happy birthday. And now let us sing together. This is a song that some of you may know. We've sung it before from time to time in this congregation. So sing along if you like, or if you'd like to just let the music wash over you. Thank you.
We shall be known by the company we keep, by the ones who circle around to tend these fires. We shall be known by the ones who sow and reap the seeds of change of life from deep within.
Many thanks to our UU congregation, Foothills, Colorado, for so generously sharing their music with us. Today we are celebrating sort of two seasonal events, May Day, the spring holiday of fertility and creativity, and International Workers' Day, right? And those two things are not disconnected, work and creativity and movement of life in the world. And yesterday, some of our families gathered to celebrate May Day, along with a maypole and flowers, and Justine Sutton was there to talk about the holiday of Beltane on the Pagan Wheel of the Year, and I've invited Justine to share a story for May Day with us before we see some images from that gathering yesterday.
Hello, good morning, everybody. Thank you, Reverend Julia. Yes, it is such a pleasure and an honor to be here today to share a story about the origins of the maypole, which was used in yesterday's celebration. And one thing I have, I'm very excited to be able to wear this flower crown. It was presented to me by Janie, one of the RE coordinators. And so yes, it's traditional at Beltane to wear flower crowns. So I feel very honored to have this special flower crown to wear. So, circle round and I'll tell you a story about how the maypole came to be. Once a long time ago, or maybe in a time not yet come, there came a springtime when no flowers bloomed, no daffodils pushed up from the cold ground, no buds formed on the roses, and no poppies opened their bright petals to the wind. And the worst thing of all was that nobody seemed to notice, except one young girl named Vivian. And Vivian said, "Where are all the flowers?" But everyone she asked seemed too busy to notice or too busy to care or just, yeah, they didn't care. And so she got really upset by this and she ran into the woods to have a little time alone and figure out what was going on. And she met a dandelion. It was the first flower she'd seen the whole year. And this was a shabby, scraggly looking little dandelion, but she was so happy to see it. And the dandelion said, "Nobody misses the flowers, so why should we bloom? Some kind of love has gone out of the world, and the earth spirits are sick and the flowers have disappeared. But with the right kind of love, you can call them back again. And Vivian said, well, what kind of love? But the dandelion didn't really know what else to tell her. So she thanked the dandelion and ran back home and gathered up all her friends, her family, everyone she could in the town center. And she said, we can bring back the flowers, but we have to find the right kind of love. So she had them all stand in a circle and hold hands and close their eyes. And after a little while, she looked around and said, it's not working. We need more kinds of love. The circle isn't big enough. No circle of love can ever be big enough to hold all forms of love, she heard a voice say. Holding her hand was a beautiful woman, her hair crowned with all the flowers of spring, her eyes deep as wells and dancing with light like the sparkling surface of a laughing stream. Who are you? Vivian asked. I am the goddess, the woman said, the queen of the May. You have called me back from the other world with your circle of love. Then we did find the right kind of love after all, Vivian cried joyfully. The May Queen smiled. There is no right kind of love, she said. The goddess blesses all forms of love. Whenever you join together in a circle with love, you call me. Then how do we bring the flowers back? Vivian asked. Here's what you must do, the May Queen said. She pointed to the center of the circle where a tall pole stood. My tree of life has become a dead stick, but you can bring it to life again. She tossed her head and from her hair, shining ribbons of all colors fell to the ground. And here are the ribbons of love. Tie each one to the top of the stick, for each ribbon stands for a different kind of love. And without all of them, my circle is not whole. Here is the love parents have for their children. Here is the love you have for your best friend. Here's the romantic love that two grown-ups can share. Here's the love you have for your pet. And they listed all the different kinds of love in their lives. Here is the love people have for each other when they work hard together. Here is the love for music and art. And here is the love that generates new ideas. Take hold of my ribbons, dance around my tree, the May Queen said. Wrap the tree of life in love and the flowers will bloom again. And so the people built a maypole and danced the maypole dance all through the day. And as they danced, daffodils pushed up from the ground and buds formed on the roses and poppies opened their bright petals to the wind. When the dance was over, the May Queen gathered all the children close to her. I must leave you now, she said, but the flowers will remain in all their different shapes and scents and sizes and colors to remind you to honor all forms of love. And the flowers remained through the whole summer. And ever after, when the spring came, the people danced the maypole with bright ribbons in honor of the flowers and all the colors of love.
Thank you to everyone who made our May Day celebration yesterday possible. And thank you to Star King for lending us their beautiful maypole. I invite you now into a time of quiet meditation and reflection. I invite you to get in touch with your breath. Feel the air moving in and out of your body. Feel your body against the chair or couch. Feel your feet against the floor, perhaps, or perhaps your back is supported by a cushion. Allow yourself to bring your awareness to right where you are. And as you bring your awareness into your body and your breath, let us move into a time of loving kindness meditation. Let us be aware that we are held in this web of love by all of those who are gathered. And let us extend those bright, shining ribbons of love out into a hurting world. Let us extend our love and compassion to all of those who are in harm's way, particularly to those in India and South America who are in the throes of another wave of this pandemic. Let us extend those shining ribbons of our love to those who are grieving, those whose lives are precarious, those who are looking for work or held in unsafe jobs or uncompensated work. And let us know that each ribbon just adds to that circle and makes that circle larger, and that we never run out of ways to create and extend that love and compassion into a world in desperate need of it. Let us enter into a time of silent reflection and meditation together.
Good morning again. On August 1st, 1947, the first two families moved into their homes in Stuyvesant Town, a newly constructed mega development complex adjacent to the Manhattan shore of the East River. The development replaced older apartment buildings that had housed over 3,100 families, some small factories, houses of worship, and schools in an area that had been known as the Gas House District. Within a matter of months, thousands of other families began to call Stuyvesant Town and Peter Cooper Village its companion development home. 4 years later, my parents, thankful to have found an apartment they could afford, left my grandparents' house and moved into one of the 11,250 units that comprised the two developments. They were so relieved to have a home of their own that, as politically aware as they were in most instances, they frankly gave little thought to anything beyond the opportunity of finally moving into Manhattan, where they both worked. On paper, and clearly from my parents' vantage point, this was a dream come true. Plans for the huge complex had begun before the end of World War II in anticipation of the influx of GIs returning to civilian life and in need of affordable housing. Designed specifically for lower middle class to middle class families, the developers hoped to attract teachers, office workers, underpaid medical residents from Bellevue Hospital, and folks staffing the newly established United Nations who would jump at the chance to live in a clean, well-maintained new apartment in a park-like setting for $50 a month. The reality, however, was nowhere as rosy as it appeared in the prospectus. The developer, the Metropolitan Life Insurance Company, had entered into an extremely beneficial public-private arrangement with the city. With conscious intent and with the blessings of the municipal government, Metropolitan Life created what was arguably the most segregated neighborhood in all of New York. Although there were other unfortunate and marginally legal aspects to the public-private arrangement, easily the most egregious was the racial policy that undergirded the entire project. Black families were strictly forbidden from renting in any part of the development. And although a private entity, MetLife had reaped enormous financial gain from the arrangement, and the courts routinely dismissed the few legal challenges to its racially exclusionary and discriminatory practices, finding that, as a private company, it had the right to, quote, select tenants of its own choosing. Few people other than those directly involved in the litigation to force MetLife to change its policies were aware of what was happening behind the scenes. Even my parents, who later became involved in the successful effort to desegregate the community, seemed willing, however grudgingly or unconsciously, to accept the racist conditions in exchange for affordable housing and the other benefits of living there. For white people fortunate enough to score an apartment, Stuyvesant Town and Peter Cooper Village represented the closest thing they could imagine to a community that cared about some working people. Although I have no statistical proof of this, I knew of several single parent households as well as a number of families with two parents who worked outside the home. Under normal circumstances, this would have meant a bunch of kids running free and unsupervised from the time school let out to whenever a parent returned back home. We were referred to at that point as latchkey kids, our door keys on chains around our necks, and left to our own devices for several hours each weekday afternoon. However, despite how pathetically retrograde Metropolitan Life was in its racial policies, the company was way ahead of the curve when it came to family life. The community it built and managed contained several playgrounds scattered amidst the 12 and 14 story apartment buildings, each one staffed by counselors dawn to dusk, 7 days a week. The counselors, generally young college students, were charged with keeping the latchkey kids safe, entertained, and content enough to stay within the confines of the playground. In addition to sports, this often took the form of preparing for and celebrating every single holiday on the calendar, secular and religious. And while I have only vague memories of decorating Christmas trees or building a sukkah, I have a clear image in my mind of the yearly construction of the maypole and the twirl of colored ribbons held in grubby little fists that signal the holiday that none of us celebrated at home. Unlike many of the other holidays we marked, no one really knew much about May Day, so it became a celebration that truly belonged to the kids. For us, the entire point was the maypole with its colorful ribbons and choreographed moves, and we were encouraged to make up stories about what any of this might mean. Meanwhile, back in the land of the adults, my parents and the parents of my best childhood friend, who were for a time card-carrying members of the Communist Party, saw this as a valuable teachable moment when Joan and I, my friend, got home from our turn around the maypole. We were inevitably treated to a history lesson that focused on the other May Day, the one that honored the struggles of workers around the world. Both the lessons about the dignity of work as well as those about the importance of unfettered creativity that I learned as my friends and I concocted stories about the meaning of the maypole, have stuck with me throughout my life. But I must confess to a particular joy I still feel many, many decades later when I reflect on how the Metropolitan Life Insurance Company inadvertently created the closest thing to a worker's paradise that most of the residents had ever encountered. For the price of a rent check, less than $90 a month when we moved in, parents could leave for work in the morning, confident that their spirited latchkey kids would be well taken care of, entertained, and on occasion, even inspired. Granted, the model smacked more of paternalism than socialism, but somehow for that brief shining moment called childhood, it eased some very challenging times.
Thank you, Ellen. Every month we partner with a project or a program and we give away a portion of our offertory to support those projects that put our values to work in the world. And this is May, and it's the beginning of a new partnership. And this month we are supporting a rather urgent and new partnership, and that is the community effort to save the San Marcos foothills. We'll be talking more about this effort and this outreach offering partner in our service next Sunday. But there are over 3,500 members of our community, along with all kinds of organizations, nonprofits, and businesses who are joining together in this multi-faith effort to save this last grasslands in the foothills of our mountains. So if you would like to support the Foothills Forever campaign and the work and ministry of this congregation in the world, you can text a dollar amount to our text to give number. You can visit our website. And I invite you now to read with me the affirmation of gratitude and giving. The words will come up on the next screen. And this is a chance for you to unmute yourself. And so we can hear each other's voices as we read aloud together. Let us be grateful.
Let us be grateful. Let us be grateful for many do not have that privilege. Let us be grateful for those who share the gifts with us.
We are enriched by the giving.
Let us be grateful for the
value that we may learn from the generosity of others.
It's not the waking or the rising, it's the grounding of a foot uncompromising. It's not forgoing of the light, it's not the opening of the eyes. It's not the waking, it's the rising. It's not the shade we should be casting, it's the light and it's the obstacle that cast it. It's the heart that drives the light, it's the fire at night. It's not the waking, it's the rising. It's not the song, but it's the singing. It's the heaven of the human spirit breathing. It is the bringing of the light, it is the bearing of the rhyme. It's not the waking, it's the rising. And I could cry power, 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 Lord. Nina cried power, Billy cried power, David cried power. And I could cry. Thank you.
To All Souls DC for generously sharing the work of their choir, of course, recorded pre-pandemic, but still wonderful to be able to enjoy it this morning. If Unitarian Universalists had an anthology of poetry, sort of the greatest hits of poems that we love and use over and over again in our communities, the poem To Be of Use by Marge Piercy might be one of the most popular entries. This is a poem that we have read to open our annual meetings, a poem we quote when we gather for social justice work, a poem beloved by board members and warming center cooking teams, and well, nearly all of us. And so this is the poem To Be of Use. The people I love the best jump into work head first without dallying in the shallows, and swim off with sure strokes almost out of sight. They seem to become natives of that element, the black, sleek heads of seals bouncing like half-submerged balls. I love people who harness themselves, an ox to a heavy cart, who pull like water buffalo with massive patience, who strain in the mud and the muck to move things forward, who do what has to be done again and again. I want to be with people who submerge in the task, who go into the fields to harvest and work in a row and pass the bags along, who are not parlor generals and field deserters, but move in a common rhythm when the food must come in or the fire be put out. The work of the world is common as mud. Botched, it smears the hands, crumbles to dust. But the thing worth doing, well done, has a shape that satisfies, clean and evident. Greek amphoras for wine or oil, Hopi vases that held corn, are put in museums, but you know they were made to be used. The pitcher cries for water to carry, and a person for work that is real. Reading the poem this time, after over a year of pandemic life, I have to admit I have a whole different relationship to the words now. I have to admit that reading that poem exhausts me. I find myself, I'm not sure anymore if I am so driven to be submerged in the task right now. If I have a willingness to yet again be harnessed to a heavy load and pull and pull and pull like an ox through the muck and the mud. It sounds a lot like what we have been doing all this past year, summoning all of our massive patience just to keep going. It was work born of necessity. And rather than being fulfilling, oftentimes it has turned out to be draining. It is real work, all right. But is that what we long for? Is this what progress requires of us? Must we operate under a state of perpetual emergency, standing in rows, putting out fires day after day? Or is there something else about our relationship to work and the demands that we place on ourselves and each other that this pandemic has revealed? The first few lines of the poem talk about a swimmer cutting through the water with sure strokes, without a pause or insecurity or cold feet. After this year, do any of us have that kind of confidence anymore to swim out into the open ocean with the assurance that a storm won't catch us off guard or a rogue wave won't come and toss us head over heels, no matter how good of a swimmer we are or how long we've been practicing our strokes? Perhaps someday we'll be able to find ourselves in that place again, that place of assurance, but it may take a while. I've been making peace with not knowing, making friends with uncertainty and insecurity, and I find myself having great compassion for the field deserters who've seen the battle one too many times and are not going to throw themselves into the war machine of unfettered capitalism anymore. And the last few lines, which always resonate so much, a pitcher cries out for water to carry and a person for work that is real. I wonder if our whole concept of what real work is has now been fundamentally altered. Instead of work that is real, perhaps this year we have learned about work that is essential, that we can't live without. We have seen who can stay home, who can shift to online life, no less real perhaps, but safer at least, and which workers must show up in person to stock the shelves or heal the sick or bring in the harvest. Do the essential grocery store workers feel their work is real in the way that Piercy means, in the way that fulfills a longing, or is it just a job that must be done? And the longings of the heart must be fed elsewhere. This is what I think International Workers' Day is all about, the longings of the heart and the realization that work is not the sum total of human existence, and nor should it be. There is work that must be done to survive, and a paycheck to be earned to pay the rent and put food on the table, and sometimes even work that is satisfying and engaging if we're lucky. But in the end, work, even essential work, even real work, is not the source of our human worth or value. One of the reasons why this faith is so important to me is that the first principle of Unitarian Universalism, the inherent worth and dignity of all people, honoring the inherent worth and dignity of all people, this is a constant countercultural reminder that we are not valuable because of how much we can produce or how much we earn, but rather we are valuable because of the simple fact of our humanity, that this shared experience of being human on this earth together makes us valuable to each other. Our dignity is intrinsic, basic, and not earned. Almost at the same time this poem was written, a Unitarian minister named Jacob Trapp wrote a hymn that is now in our gray hymnal, hymn number 139, "Wonders Still the World Shall Witness." This was written, I think, in 1981 or 1982. And Trapp was born in 1899, which means that he was over 80 when he penned the words to this hymn. And he had lived and ministered through most of the 20th century, saw two world wars and the Great Depression, and then had lived through the boom years in the middle of the century. And at the end of his days, he was filled with optimism about the trajectory that we were on. And so we have a recording of this hymn, and I have this recording that we made for this year because I'd recorded it for an earlier service at the beginning of this year, but events overtook us, and the optimism and sort of the feeling, the upbeat mood of this hymn was all wrong for what we were confronting at the beginning of this year. And so I'd kind of parked this hymn for a future date, and then it came up in relationship to this service. And so I want you to hear it now. Us to that vision of beloved community, but I have found it hard this year to really get to that place where the hymn is calling us to be able to see that optimistic vision of the future. And this hymn in some ways emerged as sort of a companion piece to Piercy's poem. Both poems have their eyes on the horizon. Both are admiring of the product of human labor. But where Piercy talks with confidence and admiration about the work of the moment, Trapp looks towards a future where new discoveries will liberate the human spirit, where people will enjoy worlds of health and human good, and where joy and labor are united. And it was this line that caught my attention, that vision of joy and labor as friends in a utopia of progress. And again, I found myself wondering this year, have we been too caught up in that need to make work more than it is? That need to make work the source of our joy and meaning and purpose? Certainly work shouldn't be unpleasant or demeaning or injure us, but perhaps it's better to know that life needs more, to expand beyond the working hours into a joyful living that can transcend career and paycheck. Our joy cannot be dependent upon a working situation that can change at any moment. That is one of the things that we have learned this year. International Workers' Day reminds me of the union slogan, 8 hours for work, 8 hours for rest, 8 hours for what you will. When all three of those things live in harmony, work and rest and leisure, the what you will, then the human spirit can flourish. That is what the labor movement is about at its core, work that recognizes itself as part of an ecosystem of living, rather than work as simply an engine for profitability. Hopefully, that part of the work will be good and satisfying, like that Greek amphora or Hopi vases that Piercy talks about. But the thing is, it won't always be satisfying. And we can't put all of our grain in one basket, no matter how beautiful that basket may have been made. I remember once back in my 20s, I was working with a temp agency and I got sent out to work in this office for a couple of weeks. And one of my tasks was taking the lunch order every day and arranging for lunch to be delivered from one of the nearby restaurants because the company paid for everyone's lunch. And this was the first time I had encountered such generosity from a company. And the restaurant meals that we ordered in were way better than the reheated leftovers that I would have packed for myself. And so I was pretty excited about this office policy. And I was talking with one of the other folks who worked there about it. And they said to me, you know, they order lunch so that we'll stay here and keep working instead of taking a longer lunch break and going out. It's all about keeping us happy and productive. And so it was. The company lunch was this lovely bribe to trade free time for work time. And it worked. Just 10 years after Jacob Trapp wrote What Wonders Still the World Shall Witness, in 1992, the economist Juliet Shore wrote The Overworked American, what has now become a classic economic book that explored why people in the United States are working so many more hours than our counterparts in other places. In the mid-20th century, as productivity increased, scientific progress fueled the dream that the workday would shrink until everyone enjoyed longer weekends, more time with family and friends, shorter workdays, right? And yet, after this drastic decrease in working hours after the Industrial Revolution, since the 1970s, the chart has turned around, and daily work has slowly but surely been on the rise again. Over and over again, we take that bribe, trading time for money, or even just lunch, with less and less in return for that trade, as the gap between those who own the companies and those who work for the companies keeps growing larger. And it is now not uncommon for two parents to work three or more jobs just to keep up with the demands of life. And in this pandemic, while those at the top have seen record income increases, the phrase side hustle has also become part of our working lexicon, a term for those in the middle or at the bottom who manage to squeeze even more productivity into their leisure hours, making a job out of something that they love to do, keeping themselves afloat with some creative entrepreneurship. There have been lots of think pieces and opinion articles written about how technology during this pandemic is going to change our working world forever. But without a fundamental shift in our cultural values around work itself, any technological adaptations we adopt will most likely still be used to benefit that small sliver of folks at the top and may push us even more towards stratification. Between those who work many hours for low wages in person and those who work many hours for higher wages in virtual spaces and those very, very few in the stratosphere who gather up the fruits of this increased productivity. My questions about this pandemic's effect on our working life are not so much about technological shifts, but about the spiritual and moral shifts that may have been ignited this past year. With technology, we've now been invited into each other's homes. We've seen our children coming in and out of the rooms. We've seen the art we have on the walls behind us, the affectionate cats, the wilting potted plants. We've lifted up the laborers who have saved us while working for nearly nothing, turning people into heroes who never wanted to be heroes, who just wanted to survive. Coming out of this pandemic, will we now be able to see each other not as individual working units who show up in an office or a warehouse or a classroom, but will we have a better sense of the interconnectedness of our labor, the wholeness of the lives of people around us, and perhaps a richer understanding for ourselves of how much more we are beyond our workspace, wherever that may be, virtual or not? And I write this sermon knowing that many of you who are gathered here this morning are retired from the working day. And you are not alone in that space. More and more of the population of this nation is over the age of 65. And I have a quick chart that shows this dramatic demographic trend. So if you'll notice, the percentage of the US population over 65 has been going up dramatically since the 1950s. We're now hovering at about 17%, and the chart projects forward into the future another couple of decades where it's just going to increase. And yet, being over the age of 65 is no longer synonymous with being retired. That book Nomadland that was just turned into a movie that won the Best Picture in the Oscars, this chronicles the lives of seniors who live in camper vans and provide seasonal work for agriculture and Amazon warehouses. That was written in 2017, and it's just getting worse. Just as with the longer work week, this trend is once again toward a longer working life. Which is why the message of solidarity, one of the core messages of May Day, is so important. And it must not just extend to the workers of this moment, but must include a multi-generational understanding of what solidarity means. True solidarity means that those of you who are in retirement feel interconnected to the lives of those who are working right now. And the workers of today understand that the culture we create will be passed on to our children and our children's children. It means solidarity across time, across the generations, understanding that the way we construct the work of the world matters to all of us. And I hope we are beginning to see the turning of the tide, a shift toward policies and practices that support people's whole lives. But we would not be here in this moment of potential for that change without the decades of advocacy and organizing that has refused to accept the relentless push for more. And so as we close our May Day service, I invite us now just to offer up our own moment of gratitude for all of those who have kept us moving toward a better and more beloved world for all people, who've helped us understand that solidarity is just another word for the bonds of love that sustain us. May it be so. Blessed be, and amen. And happy May Day. Let us now sing one more song together. This is a version of a hymn that we know, but it's sung in this rendition by the fabulous John Legend. Sing along if you like.
I knew how it would feel to be free. I wish I could break all the chains holding me. And I wish I could say all the things that I should say. Say them loud, say them clear, for the whole world to hear. I wish I could share all the love that's in my heart. Remove all the bars that keep us apart. And I wish you could know what it means to be me. Then you see and agree that every man should be free.
As we come to the end of our service this morning and prepare to move out into this beautiful May day, to go out and thank all of the workers in the world for that which keeps us going and surviving through the hardest of times. May the light of love shine upon you, out from within you, be gracious unto you, and bring you peace. For this is the day we are given. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. And let us call out a blessing. For being with us this morning, and I hope you'll stick around for some conversation and connection as we break up into our virtual coffee hour in just a few minutes. If you would like to fill out our guest book so that we can keep in touch, we're going to go ahead and post that link in the chat again so you can let us know how best to reach out to you. We hope you'll stick around and get to know us at coffee hour. And also we have the link to our text to give and our giving information. If you did not get a chance to do that during the offertory, now is a great time to go ahead and support the congregation and the work in the world that we partner with. And thank you so much for being here. We're going to take a minute to just refresh your coffee or take a quick break and come right back to this space, and we will move into a time of conversation and community. So hang out here and join us for our coffee hour in just a moment.